Welcome, Bomi. Thanks for making time for our Dialogue with Darwin series. Firstly, your work experience, right? You've told me that you've worked across continents, worked across a cross-section of sectors, over a couple of decades at least. Wanted to understand your thoughts on how leadership development and coaching have changed over time.
I think what is essential to understand is that, just to set the context, if we look at it, human beings have been in existence over the last 10,000 years or so. But it's in less than the last 2,000 years that you see certain developments that have been taking place. And then you come to industrialization, which completely changed the way things happen. Fourth revolution, if I were to put it, in context of the speed at which change is taking place, especially in context with the kind of automation that is happening. Even within the IT industry today, there is a tendency to think that repetitive roles, when that gets automated, that actually artificial intelligence is coming into play. But that's not the reality. In the same way, the pace of change which has been happening, say 2 decades back, the expectation was to have probably 4, 5, 6 leaders to be developed over a large time frame, say 5 years, 6 years, in the business context. Today, if you're talking about 4 or 5 individuals within an organization to be built from a leadership standpoint, you're falling way short of the mark. When I say you're falling way short of the mark, simply because the number of verticals that need to come into play, those numbers by itself, from a sustenance perspective, needs to be 5+. And then within those businesses, you have the sub-group below that leader, which is another 4 or 5 members. So you're talking about approximately around 25 to 30 members in the leadership bench with a shelf life of 9 months to maximum of 2 years. You can't really wait for 4 quarters to see those results, even from a leadership standpoint. So you're constantly not really waiting for those challenges to come up, but really throwing challenges at individuals. And while you're doing that, you're fine-tuning as to what requires to be done from a developmental perspective for them to really outshine in those challenges and hone those competencies that they need to excel in, right? Over the last 2 decades, it's changed 180 degrees. The time frame has changed. The kind of flexibility that they need to have today versus building the rigidity part of it that used to happen 2 decades back, all of that has changed. Even if I were to look at from some of the core competencies that across organizations need to come up, the traditional top-down method no longer exists. When I say the traditional top-down method, as human beings, we have a tendency to want to control, right? But the CEO no longer can manage by controlling. What he can manage is by actually having his ear to the ground, understanding what the front line is saying, and really taking it back from the front line towards the top in terms of how, what, where the policies need to change, and getting the leadership to really be able to adapt to that, be flexible to taking that in and making it happen. So he's no longer really controlling in terms of what needs to happen. He's only listening to the bottom in terms of what are they responding based on what the customer is saying to be able to make that change happen.
An organization has to become very, very agile, and you're saying it requires a different breed of leader. But it's not easy to change, right? If you evolve to a certain extent, you become senior, it's very difficult to change. How will you make that change happen for leadership to continue to remain relevant? Because stability at the top is also very, very important from a vision standpoint.
True.
How do you make that change happen?
I think one of the fundamental issues, and that's part of what I was talking about as far as some of the competencies that have completely undergone a change. And when I was saying in context to the CEO really needing to listen down to the front line to be able to bring those changes, is the context of survival. When I say the context of survival, what's really happening is that if we stick to the ant mentality of thinking that here is the horde of ants that are going to march in line to be able to produce something, that's no longer true. Why is it no longer true? There are enough and more caterpillars that are changing into butterflies, which have got nothing to do with the ant world, right? And that level of disruption that you're talking about, an Uber or an Airbnb or an Amazon for that matter, they are not manufacturing setups. They are not owning cars. They are not owning hotels, right? So the supply chain itself is somewhere else, somebody else, something else. That's on one end. And the customer on the other end is absolutely everybody. So it's no longer the trader part of the world which is making sense, right? With that level of disruption which is taking place, from a leadership standpoint, if you're not able to influence, now coming to the point that you were talking about, if you're not able to influence, if you're not able to sell, if you're not able to make sense for the customer, then you're dead. I think for a very large workforce, this is where the challenge comes in. Because leadership at a global level itself, from societies at large, to coming down to nations, to coming down to organizations as minuscule units, there's an absence of leadership. That absence of leadership has to do everything with the ability to influence and make you see my point of view.
Absolutely.
Right? It's only when I'm able to make you see my point of view will you be able to actually go through that process of stop being an ant and start being the caterpillar to change into a butterfly.
Very interestingly, we talked about leadership now, right? It's also important for organizations to groom the next layer of leadership, people at the mid-management level. From a market standpoint, what are some of the best practices that you are seeing? What companies are doing to actually have mid-management ready for the next stage of disruption cycles, right?
Two things that I would change in context with what you said. Number one, I don't think organizations are grooming. They're not. I think they're striving to facilitate, and I would carefully use this terminology, because when we say grooming, it's actually facilitating in a very structured manner. But when I say striving to facilitate, it's like they're trying to put pieces together. They're trying to put pieces together in a here and now context and do it, number one. Number two, when you say mid-management, I think they're striving to do it for the leadership top line. And they're fairly neglecting as far as the middle management is concerned. Last 15 years or so, from McKinsey's time of war for talent, that war for talent is really the middle management, because that's what they're trying to do in terms of bringing in purely ready-made talent from outside that'll be able to fix this issue here and now over the next 6 months, you know? So as organizations, they're really not focused onto the middle management. That's because the struggle is very much there even as far as senior management is concerned. What's this struggle which is there in the senior management? They expect by the time you're there in the top layer that you have both. You have a breadth that you understand across functions, and therefore folks that have gone and really worked in different functions are doing much better. And at the same time, you expect that individual in the same breadth to also have the depth to be able to, like the CEO, get in, you know, right to the bottom and listen very acutely to what's happening with each individual. So you want the depth and you want the breadth, right? And you want it yesterday. So unfortunately,
organizations are not facility at all. Right?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, if you don't give time from a leadership grooming perspective, it's not going to happen.
Right?
In those circumstances, all you can do is you can constantly, as you see opportunities, facilitate to get them to develop, right? I notice entrepreneurs over the last 10 years or so also have this expectation that they would be able to facilitate and groom leaders in 4.5 months' time when it takes actually for a child 9 months to be born. You know, it's just not going to happen.
Coming down to the last layer, right? You've also been an entrepreneur. What are some things that you learned as an entrepreneur about the HR function that you never realized as a functional guy before?
Sure. So let me take the first part of it. I think as far as geographies are concerned, if I were to look at US and India, they're chalk and cheese. Whether it's the US market, Singapore market, there is a very strong adherence to systems, a very strong adherence to rules, policies, process, right? Dramatically different when it comes to India. We still want to go and look up the minimum wage simply because we want to find ways and means of tweaking around that to be able to, you know, look at a cost arbitrage per se, rather than saying this is the policy, I will go up over and above the minimum wage, look at how do I cut down on the number of headcount and at the same time producing twice or thrice better results, right? To give you one example, in US, a standard practice, you want to fire somebody, you'll make sure that an ambulance is around, right? You'll typically make sure that it's happening on a Saturday or a Friday at the end of the week, right? Here, it does not matter. Forget an ambulance. You are literally telling the individual, you've lost your job, you put in your papers, I'm not going to terminate your service, you put in your papers. We will do your full and final at some point in time. It's 180 degree difference between the two, even as far as a small process of this kind.
But between the West and the East, I know you've worked in Dubai, in India. Are there subtleties to these individual geographies
yes,
as well?
Yes, very much so, very much so. So it's geographies, it's also industries. So obviously when you look at policies, you are looking at the region, you are looking at the location, you're also looking at the specific industry per se. Right. Because even within each of these locations, the industry has its own flavor, it has its own practices, it has its own, I would say, business maturity curve, right? And those business maturity curve makes all the difference basically as far as people practices are concerned. To come to that second part that you asked about as far as entrepreneurship is concerned, I think I've been lucky in many ways that I've had more than one functional role that I have been through. And this has been through very early stages. Right. And that gives you a flavor. When you're handling sales, for example, it gives you a flavor and gives you an understanding how much more effort and homework needs to be done before you go and sell an idea, even from an HR perspective is concerned, right? And that's within the internal customer per se. Or for that matter, when you're getting into depth as far as marketing is concerned, how is it different from a sales perspective? And a combination of all of this when you're an entrepreneur. As an entrepreneur, you're constantly keeping in mind the multiple roles that you're going to be playing and how quickly you need to change one hat from the other in context of whom you're dealing or what you're dealing with, and therefore what's the kind of priority at that moment that you need to really focus up with. I think the good part for an entrepreneur is you're not worried about your job description. You're not trying to build around those boundaries that typically you would set for yourself when you're getting into an organizational context is concerned.
Is there something you learned more about the HR function when you became an entrepreneur as opposed to your experience as a HR functional person before?
I think only bit I would say is nuances that an entrepreneur goes through and a far better understanding to that extent for me dealing with the entrepreneurs when I come back into the corporate world. I think I'm a lot more sensitive towards the entrepreneur, a lot more sensitive towards what he's going through or she's going through, the challenges that she or he is facing on a day-to-day basis, versus what I would have if I had not been an entrepreneur myself.
Then next, we'll move to something that's more fun. So we have a rapid-fire round for you. Should probably not take more than 5 seconds for each question. So let's start. You ready, Bomi?
Sure.
So one advice that you have to the HR function?
Look at the line manager.
One adjective for HR that you'd swear everybody should live by?
People person.
Favorite book?
Jonathan Livingston Seagull.
Fantastic. In love with that myself. One thing that you can't stand at all?
Procrastination.
Your stress buster? Do you keep a ball on your table?
No, listening to people.
Your hangout at work?
I think it's anywhere where I'm comfortable in the outdoors.
Somebody that you take inspiration from?
There are too many of them. Mahatma Gandhi.
Thanks for your time, Bomi. It was,
thank you.
As always, a pleasure talking to you and hosting you at
My pleasure.
Dialogue
My
with pleasure. Darwin. Thank My you. Pleasure.